virus headquarters. Who really needs to self-quarantine? And for how long?
We can do this if we meet the challenge together.
Plus, we are answering your critical coronavirus questions.
How does health insurance? Can I get tested?
I've tried to buy hand sanitizer online. Can I just make my own? I had a trip planned. Should I cancel?
Coming up next. Season 11 starts now.
It's day 52 of the coronavirus here in America. The WHO has just announced this is now a pandemic. And today we're asking the question in everyone's mind, should we be quarantining more people and closing more schools? Just days ago, the nation of Italy took the unprecedented step to quarantine the whole country. We're joined now by famed virus hunter Dr. Ian Lipkin from Columbia University. He was actually personally quarantined after returning from China, where he was researching COVID-19, one of the first Americans to go there and do that. So just because it's a pandemic doesn't mean this is Armageddon. Right? It's just a word used to describe further spread of the virus. But from our perspective in the United States, it doesn't change much.
I agreed. It doesn't change anything. The virus is global. It's certainly all over the United States at present. It's in every country in Europe. So I don't think it really makes any difference.
Well, let's start with the breaking news of colleagues of yours on the amount of time this virus can live on surfaces. I've been searching for an answer to that, and I've heard ranges quite long, quite short. We now know how long a virus that I were to cough on this table here would last. How many days, how many hours?
Yeah, so Vincent Munster and a team at NIH in Rocky Mountain Labs in Hamilton, Montana, have recently completed a study. We hope those data will be publicly available soon in an actual scientific article. But their data suggests that it can last for at least 48 hours on plastic or metal.
40 to 2 days, you're at risk if someone touched it. So if you're walking to a public area, if you're holding the like you're supposed to, the pole in the subway or the hand hook, is that a wise thing or not?
Well, this is a concern. And I, for years, have said that my preference is to wrap my arm around a pole. But if I can't do that, then I wear gloves. And I think this is a reasonable thing for people to do to prevent the transmission of this virus.
Yeah, but if you're riding the subway or the bus or any public transportation, a cab, you're going to be touching surfaces of others that who you don't know.
That's correct.
There's some very big advances in the treatment of people who have COVID-19 that you just brought to my attention. This stuff is just breaking news, everyone. One of them involves taking the blood from a person who's already had the illness, taking those antibodies and putting it in someone who's about to die. And what's that data from your colleagues in China showing?
So, right, as you say, it's from my colleagues in China. The communicating author on this paper is Chen Zhu, who's the former Minister of Health. And what Chen Zhu and his colleagues have found is that if you take plasma, which is basically a component of blood which doesn't have any blood cells in it, and you give this to somebody who is very, very ill, that in a series of 10 patients, they were able to save every single one of these patients. Mm. They were able to reduce disease, the time for virus shedding. So this is very, very promising. Now, larger trials will be needed to ensure that this can be reproduced, but I'm confident that this is going to make a difference. So these are very, very promising times. It suggests that we're going to have some therapies which we can use immediately.
Even if you don't have an immunization, even if you're sick, we finally can begin to use modern medicine. Let me show you a little animation just so you understand this, because it's pretty cool. So antibodies are proteins that bind to the spikes of the coronavirus. Those blue things are binding to the coronavirus. That prevents the virus from docking onto receptors in your lungs. So if those blue antibodies from somebody else who already made those antibodies to save their own life, you could benefit from that as well. And I love that fact because it takes away a lot of the challenges that modern medicine has faced with coronavirus. If you do get the infection and you have those antibodies I just showed that you could use to save somebody else, will those also save you? Can you get reinfected?
There's a lot of controversy still about whether or not you could be reinfected. I think the important thing to emphasize is that for this to work, those people who've recovered have to be willing to donate. We also will shortly have data that will be coming back from trials of a variety of drugs, which I think will also be important. And of course, people are pushing full steam ahead on trying to get vaccines, but those are many, many months away.
If you do get sick from the coronavirus, and many of yours are going to just because it's contagious, how long should you expect to be ill? Is this a week? Could it be just a day or two? Could it be 6 weeks?
Well, some people have no disease at all. Some people have very mild disease. In fact, the majority of people have very mild disease and wouldn't necessarily even know that they needed to go to a healthcare facility. But if you get severe disease and you get hospitalized in an ICU, even without treatment, most people will recover, and those people will recover within a period of 1 to 2 weeks.
If you do have the infection, if it was so mild you barely recognize you were ill, how long are you contagious for?
That's also something that we don't have a good fix on, but I would say a maximum of 2 weeks. The challenge is that some people are infectious even before they begin to have symptoms. Mm. This is not uncommon, actually, because the virus starts in the upper respiratory tract before it goes down. And in the upper respiratory tract is where you have nasal secretion, saliva, so you're much more likely to release infectious particles. And if you rub your nose and then you rub a subway handle, somebody else comes along, grabs the same strap, and then we have a small outbreak.
Yeah, we're not so small sometimes. Spanglish train there on. Lessons from China on this mass quarantine. I know when it initially happened, a lot of folks were skeptical about it. Their actions are being copied in other countries now. Does mass quarantine work? Do you anticipate we might have something similar happening here if required?
In China, it clearly slowed down that outbreak. And the major advantage was not even so much for the Chinese, but for the rest of the world. It allowed us to get ready to develop the diagnostic test, to start thinking about vaccines and drugs. So I think we owe them a great debt of gratitude. Now, as you know, today many schools decided that they're no longer going to have in-person meetings. At Columbia, we have a limit of 25 people for any mass gathering, with sort of, and the number is somewhat arbitrary, but the idea is that the more people you have, the higher the probability that someone in that group will be infected and has the potential to infect other people.
So you brought some examples of how the testing actually happens. So when doctors are getting samples from you, they get it from your nose or the back of your throat. They're placed in little wells, ultimately, and they look like this. And then this goes into a machine, as you were describing to me. This Murabank right. Not be on there.
Yeah, so there are 96 wells on this plate. This goes into a robot. Each individual well is sampled with a little straw that comes in, sucks out the liquid, puts it into an analyzer. The data then come out that are reviewed by scientists. There are larger versions of this plate that have 384 wells, but this is the traditional sort of 96-well plate, and it looks just like this. This, in fact, is one of these said test kits.
So we're reliant on these. We need more of these in order to test more people. Otherwise, we don't really have an idea of what this virus is doing in our community. But what we do know is that people who are ill make other people ill very quickly. So in D.C., there's a pastor who gave out communion, and during that process, shook a lot of hands. Many of those folks have fallen sick, leading to the quarantine of hundreds. In fact, Ted Cruz and other lawmakers have quarantined themselves after someone at a conservative conference fell ill as well. Do you think these self-quarantines are worthwhile?
I think that self-quarantine is certainly worthwhile. I've been through it, as you know, not too long ago. You have to have the resources to do it, and that's what's difficult. People who are single, for example, how do they isolate themselves? One of the things we're very worried about is homeless people in America. They don't have shelter, they're malnourished, they're immunosuppressed frequently, and they live in these very, very large shelters. It's going to be very difficult to protect these 500,000 or so people who are homeless in this country, and this is something that we need to address.
Air Force One may have been compromised as well. Matt Gaetz was put into quarantine while aboard the plane with President Trump. It's been reported they isolated him in a separate part of the plane. Do you think that's enough? And you think the president ought to be tested? Does he get self-quarantined because he was with someone who was exposed?
I don't think I can tell the president what to do. A lot of people have been trying to do that. But I do know this. Handshaking is passe. This is not something we can do right now. So I prefer this.
Elbow bump. A personal question. My son just sent me news that his university is shut down, that all the kids are going to be sent home, the classes are going to be all remote. Is this a rational thing to do? These are all young, healthy people who probably would have been okay if they got the virus.
So we have the same thing. I have two stepkids. One at Harvard, one at Amherst. Both of them are being sent home. And they have classmates who, some of them will be coming home with them. You know, large classes are opportunities for exchange of viruses, bacteria, all kinds of other problems. So I don't think that these schools have any alternative. Now, what kind of an effect will it have on those classes? Those kids, as you say, are typically young and they probably would have done fine. But they would have become infected and they could have infected other people. So what we're trying to do is place a sort of a cordon around these areas where we've identified people as being infected. So it's like a fire break so that it can't go beyond that point. It's old fashioned, but it actually works.
Clunky but effective, Dr. Lipkin. Thank you very much. I want to talk more about quarantines and school closures and why they can be really effective. The coronavirus can spread directly when a sick person breathes, coughs, or sneezes onto a healthy person, or indirectly if a healthy person touches a contaminated surface, then touches their face. So diseases can spread very fast. Now, as a case study, let's look at New York's second confirmed coronavirus case. It's a 50-year-old married father of four who resides about 20 miles outside the city. Now, here's what happened. Those now infected who had either direct or indirect contact with him include his wife, son, and daughter, right? They had no idea, right? Then there's the neighbor that drove him to the hospital, and then his friend's wife, and three of their four children. Right? Then three members and the leader of his house of worship, right? Two of his friends, right? Two people who worked at an event that he attended, and then three people connected to the hospital where he was originally taken. Are you getting an idea here? This is the tip of the iceberg, right? And think about the people that these people saw. This patient is believed to be the common denominator in at least, look at this, 113 cases and counting. And it's not his fault, not at all. This is just the nature of the contagious virus we are dealing with. It's why you're hearing people in your community question if we should be closing things like schools. When we come back, ABC News' trusted medical correspondent and my very good friend, Dr. Jen Ashton, is here to weigh in on whether we should close schools. Plus, your most critical coronavirus questions, we're going to answer them all. Stay around.
The latest on the coronavirus pandemic.
So stay informed, stay wise, and take the steps that can help you.
Scammers preying on people's...